three variations of programs to share as case studies on how theater deeply impacts community, both that smaller community of the people who are participating in a program, as well as that community at large, the neighborhood or the city in which that program is conducted. This is an opportunity for us to both learn from the successes of these programs as well as the lessons and the challenges that we have faced with these programs that we are doing, hopefully to be able to take that back to our own work in our own communities and neighborhoods. I'm going to briefly introduce our panelists and guide them through a series of questions about each of their programs and then leave some time for Q&A at the end. So today we have with us Marsha Copeland, the Director of Education of the Repertory Theater of St. Louis, Evelyn Francis, the Acting Artistic Director of Theater Offensive, and Joanne Seelig, Director of Education at Imagination Stage. The programs that they are going to share with us today illustrate how theater education and engagement can take an active role in developing that community trust and understanding that is so critical for our theaters to do in today's world. So without further ado, let's go ahead and begin with Marsha. Marsha, do you mind just taking about 5 minutes each to introduce your program and yourself a little bit before I dive into some specific questions for you?
Good morning, and thank you for letting me talk about this program. Being an ex-teacher, I have show and tell and handouts, so make sure afterwards that you do that. Connecting community through the arts started as part of the TCG Revolution grant, and it was a cohort grant that took an arts organization, an education organization, and a theater organization working together to do a program over an 18-month period. You can't see the slide well enough, but it says, over the past 18 months, the project engaged community members from middle school to 94-year-olds in celebrating Meacham Park, which has a very vibrant history and also a very turbulent history. Meacham Park started in 1890. It was this amazing community, but it had no services. It had no sewer, no water. It was its own thing. And in 1970, they were annexed by the city of Kirkwood. And they finally got government and sewer services. And within a year, Kirkwood declared eminent domain and took one-third of the community and turned it into a Lowe's and Target and Kohl's shopping area. So a lot of the stories and the history of Meacham Park is disappearing. On top of that, there were some very violent reactions, and Meacham Park became that area. You don't go to Meacham Park, and it's not safe, and it's not, they're those people. And this was in current history. This is in the lifetime of these kids' parents. And in their lifetime, they're hearing this story. So we worked with the Meacham Park Neighborhood Improvement Association and with the community to find a way to tell these stories. So what we did is students from the journalism class, if you can go to the next one for me, students from the journalism class of Nyfer Middle School, which serves this area as well as all of Kirkwood, did anecdotal interviews of community members or people who had connections to the community, maybe white people that grew up in the area. We talked to high school students. We did some people by Skype. We were so lucky that Mrs. Janetta Haley, who is 94 years old and was the first black teacher in the Kirkwood School District, came and spoke with the kids. The community members were so generous with giving their time. So we did all of these anecdotal interviews in various ways. The kids took a field trip with Pastor Ike, and they walked Beecham Park. And they saw where the different parts of Beecham Park were and different things that were happening. And then they took those stories and they wrote articles. And those articles became a book. We also gave the articles they wrote, and what is my favorite part of this book is you have all this wonderful information they wrote, but you also have their reactions at the bottom. And things like, my parents have always told me this, and now I realize I need to find some things for myself. Or I need to think about and meet people, not just listen to what's been said. But we gave this to visual artists, three visual artists, and to some performers. And the visual artists created this stunning artwork. Here's the book, this stunning artwork. This is Stereotype. And based on the stories they wrote, and I have to tell you, one of my favorites, it's at the top of the handout, it's the cover of our book, because when Mrs. Haley took her job, 15,000 people signed a petition to get rid of her. And there are 15,000 blocks. She was the chorus teacher. And there are 15,000 blocks on here and her hands because she took them to state championships. And all of a sudden, people loved having her. But people were very honest with the kids. They remembered they were talking to kids, but she talked about taking her class for ice cream after a win, and she had to stay outside because she couldn't be served. And these were things the kids had not heard. So we had visual art, and then we also turned it into a performance, and you can kind of see that we had the artwork on stage as our background. And some poets, post-show discussion, sorry, a talk back. But we had the actors, the director, the percussionist, that could then kind of talk about their feeling and having done this work and what they wanted to say. And then my favorite comment is a gentleman walked out and said, I thought I'd come to the rep to be entertained. I didn't know that I'd be educated too. I'm almost 8 years old and was educated by 11, 12, 13, and 14-year-olds. Because these kids heard these stories and went, why? Why are we acting like this and why didn't we know this? So a side effect of this that we did not plan because it was going to end with these performances is the city of Kirkwood is building a community theater that will be built in another year. And they would like this performance to be their opening performance. So it has made a big difference in the Beecham Park Neighborhood Improvement Association, and it has also made Kirkwood kind of stand up and say, yeah, we have this. There are two documentaries because the kids, we also made documentaries of this. There is a 16-minute documentary and a 7-minute overview, which were too long to show today, but if you want this, this gives you the links to see it. And it's pretty amazing to hear these kids and to see how generous the community members were and how honest with their stories and the impact it made.
So talk to me about, I mean, this is an 18-month project. Mm-hmm. So how did this project come about? What was the impetus for your theater to do this project and to become involved?
We have a need. We are outside the city. We're in Webster Groves, and we're kind of considered suburb. And yet, in Webster Groves, North Webster is one of the oldest black communities in the state of Missouri. And then you have Meacham Park, which is a community in flux. And we felt that that's our neighborhood. That's our community. And we wanted to help tell that story. And through this grant, Webster Arts, which is primarily a visual arts foundation, and then Springboard to Learning, which goes into schools, we kind of sat down and said, how can we help save these stories? How can we help give these people an avenue to tell their stories and their history and have it documented? So it was tell you we started out with North Webster, and we were going to tell the history. And some egos got involved, and North Webster chose not to work with us. And we went to Meacham Park, and they were very pleased to have us. And it ended up being so much better because this was immediate. These kids were living this. It wasn't someone saying, let me tell you about my grandmother. It was high school students saying, let me tell you what I'm going through right now.
So were the students then that were part of that journalism class, mm-hmm. did they reside in that neighborhood?
They live in Kirkwood. They are Kirkwood students. Some of them reside in the neighborhood. Some of them reside in the neighborhoods that don't go into Meacham Park. So it was helping them get rid of what they've always heard and finding out what the truth was.
Again, going back to the fact that this is just an 18-month project, is this something that your theater would think about doing again? And or how does this project inform the rest of your education programming now moving forward?
Big question. It is something that was one of the reasons that we wanted the documentary to be part of it, so that this is something we can share. The actors are ready to do the performance again anytime, but again, they had to move on with their lives. So I don't know that this will ever be done, that Meacham Park will do this again, but it is a process that anybody could use in any neighborhood and have anyone, it is totally reproducible. And we do have the books that are available. It is, as with so many education departments, we're doing things for children, we're doing audience enhancement, and we're doing community engagement. So will we do a project like this? I don't know that I'll have 18 months to immerse in a community again. Do I hope we will? Yeah. Okay. But it will depend on funding and time and resources.
Evelyn, let's go ahead and focus a bit on Theater Offensive and your program now. If you could introduce yourself and the program in the 5-minute period, that would be appreciated.
In a 5-minute period. Operative thing. So I think, so the Theater Offensive is an LGBTQ specific theater company in Boston. And we are working with community, specifically youth community, but we also have programs that are not youth specific. So I am an activist and a performer, a director, and an artist. And so for a lot of us in this room, teaching and doing educational programs has come from who we are. So I wanted to use a minute to say who I am and then let the young people speak for themselves about who they are and what this program is in order to bring some youth voice into this room, which is very central to our work. So I was born in Cincinnati, Ohio, and I have never met a queer person in my entire life, 17 years. And so I left Cincinnati and went to Southern Baptist College in Central Kentucky, which is a really good move when you're trying to find queer people. I went there, and it was not said that you couldn't be queer, but we knew teachers who were fired after they came out. And there were, I think, two students who came out, and one student had human feces spread on his door, and another had firecrackers under his door. And this was at a religious college. And so I knew it wasn't safe to be out and to be who I was. And then I met my future wife there, which my mother, she'll kill me for saying this on camera, but she told me not to marry a Catholic, and I didn't. I just didn't. So, good Southern Baptist girl. I'm sure that's what my mother intended. So I knew that in order to survive, I had to get out of that place. I wouldn't survive it otherwise. So I applied to a school that my college roommate applied to, and I thought, she's going, I'll be safe. And I ended up at Emerson College studying theater education. Mm-hmm. Theater, of course, as for a lot of us, was the saving grace. It was where you could find a lot of queer people, even if they weren't saying that they were queer, you could find a lot of queer people, and you could be around people who felt the way that you felt about the world. And once I was in Boston, I couldn't believe that there were gay straight alliances. I couldn't believe that 14-year-olds were coming out to their parents. It was just not a world I understood. And so for my thesis project, I decided to focus in and work with a group of community youth to see the impact of devising work from their original stories and what that impact would be on them. And I realized what an impact it had on me, too. I felt like these 14, 16, 9-year-olds, 19-year-olds, rather, were teaching me how to come out as a 24-year-old at that time. So in the audience of my thesis project was the founder of the Theater Offensive. And he said, we have this little job. I wonder if you'd apply for it. And that was in 2001. And I became the part-time teaching artist Theater Offensive in 2001, became the education director in 2006, in 2010 was promoted to the director of programs, and now I'm the acting artistic director. So I've been there for a very long time. Don't do the math, okay? I want to show you a video of young people. So in the last couple of years, documentary filmmaker Ellen Brodsky made a documentary about True Colors. And this is just a clip of some of their work, them talking about what True Colors is and the work that they're doing in community. And specifically, the young people create and tour original work, and they're touring to audiences that hold power in their lives. That's a critical part of our work. So they are speaking to the principals who make it hard for them to go to school, to the students who make it miserable every day in gym class, to the government agencies who are their clinicians and social workers who don't understand how they navigate the world. So they're speaking to audiences that hold power and trying to shift the script for them to have the power for just a moment. They have to shut up and listen to the young people. So I want them to speak for themselves about what the program's like for them. Let's hope the sound works.
True Colors, when you meet a person and stuff like that, you feel like you know them for like a year.
Lifetime.
Yeah, like a lifetime.
True Colors is a theater troupe that serves kids from 14 to 22 in the LGBTQ community, and it's more than just about acting, it's about really spreading awareness of issues in the queer community.
Hi, Sarah, how was your day?
It's fine.
Just fine.
Yes, fine. I'm Armenian, and my family is very conservative.
What do you mean?
When my father discovered I was gay, he said in a very soft, monotone voice, be normal. Two words couldn't just kill you.
Why do you always talk to my family? He doesn't know about us. He doesn't know about us. It's your man. I'm a man. We're not supposed to be together.
Before I came to True Colors, I really trying to be discreet with my sexuality. I didn't like to speak up as much.
Okay, now, pick up my book.
True Colors, I saw how people were comfortable in their own skin, and it influenced me to get out of my shell, just to, you know, be myself.
When we go to True Colors, labels are gone. They're gone. They're just taken away, and you're just you.
Tejana says she's never been more real. She's never found a place where she can be as honest as she's been able to be with herself. As chaotic as the world can be, as chaotic as a life for GLBTQ youth can be, she feels like this is a place where she can rest.
Honey, you are you, and there is no change in that. I love you, and God loves you.
I just think they're groundbreaking. This is a space where youth can put their words out into the world.
I don't care what anyone has to say. I am a gay black male who loves God, and God loves this gay black male.
I mean, I feel so many different things. Like, I feel like crying, I feel like smiling, I feel like just screaming amen.
I
said this needed to be said to open the mind to the acceptance of everybody.
There were definitely some kids who I think were like really kind of like, oh my gosh, those two boys just kissed. Or oh my gosh, those two girls just kissed. But by the end of it, oh yeah, two boys just kissed. No big deal. You know, like I feel like it would be great for all kids to see that.
But look.
See? I told you you could pull this look off. Kind of look like a bro. I mean,
it touched me personally, being a trans man. Just to have this on stage, I was crying actually in the audience because it just touched me so much.
I don't think that you could overstate the impact of this play.
How does it feel to kiss your own gender?
A lot of these kids, they probably haven't heard people their own age say that they were gay, so I think that one was going to stick with a lot of these students forever.
I'm going to get my swag on too.
Yes!
I'm going to try to make a difference for other people, whether you're gay or bi or transgender or have autism. You still are a human being, and you have the rights to love yourself and do what you want to do, what your heart desires.
Part of it with stipulations about what it meant for a documentary crew to be in the community. They approved a study with Boston Children's Hospital that they did. The young people approved expanding to an advanced ensemble, so it means that young people who aged out or felt they had gotten the skills they needed to in the troupe would move on to a more advanced program. And then they also approved a series of workshops, so people could do one-off workshops and be in the community for shorter stints of time.
Thank you. Joanne, why don't we take some time to hear about you and your program?
My name is Joanne Smith-Lamparter. I'm the Director of Education at Imagination Stage. Imagination Stage is a theater for young audiences. Our base is in Bethesda, Maryland, which is in Montgomery County, and it's about 30 minutes from Washington, D.C. But it's important to know that we also are incorporated in Washington, D.C., so we're Imagination Stage, and then Imagination Stage, D.C. And that influences our programming, and both sort of feed into each other. And we serve ages 1 to 18 through after-school programming, camps, school partnerships, and community programs, as well as our professional theater, which we have 5 main stage productions per year, as well as theater for the very young. But the program that I'm going to discuss today is our partnership with police departments. And we partner with the Washington, D.C. Police Foundation, the Montgomery County Department of Police, the Montgomery County Department of Recreation, as well as all of the youth parents that participate in the program are large partners, but they don't have a logo. And as well as the schools that the students are in also play a large role. So, we can go on to the next slide. I'm just gonna actually, we'll just go through some of the pictures first and then I can explain a little bit better. Partners to to be what our partners want it to be, what Imagination Stage wants it to be, without having to be what the grant needs it to be. And then at some point, you know, as we're scaling that, there may be a great opportunity that is a natural fit, but it takes the pressure off. But we always start with ensemble and trust, so it's always improv and theater games at the beginning to really build listening. We move on to technique and skill building, then individual personal narratives, and then at the end, devising, so that there is a sharing towards the end. When we work in the school setting, that audience is really, and the focus is on bettering the school, so any artwork is made for the school and the school community and given to the school, and the school administrators along with the parents are invited. When we work in summertime in DC, it's more community-based, so the focus is on the neighborhood. So we choose the theme based on where we're working.
What is the length of the program? How many sessions, you know,
sure,
do you have through that process? What is the contact hours for this?
Sure, about 20 to 22 hours is standard. In the summertime, it's every day over a week. In after school time, then it's once a week for a couple hours.
And you have talk to me about the retention rate, particularly with the summertime one when you're not in that school setting, but also with the police officers. I mean,
sure.
How do you get that consistency of attendance for that meaningful work throughout the
school? So that is, the summertime is actually key for that. So condensed amount of times rather than once a week is actually, that was what we were told from the officers in terms of attendance and consistency. So when we started and we did once a week, I assumed that that would be easy because it means just missing your job for a couple hours a week, but actually that proved a lot harder. And because of different rotations, we ended up not having consistent officers, and then we saw it affect the student retention. So we had students who were eager to go, who did make bonds really quickly, and then when that officer didn't show, it felt personal, and so then they stopped wanting to come. So when we can do holiday breaks for summertime, it is actually easier from a scheduling perspective. During the summer, it's part of DC summer youth employment, so they are required to attend. During the year, the students, we have a dinner with the parents and the students and the officers and the artists, so we all have dinner together at the very beginning, and we have dinner, we talk about the program, the officers talk about themselves, parents like to share. But then at the end, we come together for dinner again. So that has also helped because the parents are really engaged as well.
I love how your model to create this program is really based on, we are going to do this within our own budget right now before we ask for grant funding to support it, which also tells me that this is something that you're investing in for a potential long-term program versus, you know, something that is more just project things, right?
Yeah.
So if you just piloted this in 2016, it's still relatively new.
Yeah.
What was the impetus for your theater to create this program? How does it align with your theater's mission? Why now?
Sure. So I'll start with our mission, and then I'll tell you how it came. Our mission, which I usually butcher, so I wrote it down, is, but I can't read my handwriting, so I'll just butcher it. is to provide students an opportunity to continue to explore and or amplify their voice and their identity in performing arts education. And so it does align in that sense, but it really, we on a different project, had a relationship with Department of Recreation and worked with Department of Health and Human Services. So we were already working with government agencies on a project that was grant funded, we still continue. And so because of that, we already had some relationships, but we didn't come up with the project. So the head of the Department of Recreation is friends with the chief of police in Montgomery County. They came up with the project and decided they wanted it to involve theater. And some of their officers do have a passion for working with the arts, but they really wanted to involve more artists. So they came to us and said, will you be involved? And my first reaction was, I can't do this, but I did not say that. So, but I said, well, a little bit. So we started really slow. So we had, they already have a project where officers work in great classrooms, and so we invited them to come with some of the classrooms to see a play at Imagination Stage, and we could do a workshop together, like a push-show workshop, and have some time together in this space. So that's actually how we started. So we both got a little bit more comfortable with the idea of working together, and then we grew from there. But we already had worked with the Department of Recreation and the DC Police Foundation while we were working with Montgomery County. They run their own youth programming. So we are fitting into their program. They have a wide variety of programs that range from like whitewater rafting, which I think I would choose that for drama in the summer, but we have a lot of kids. They run ropes, they do ropes courses, but most of them are physical, they have sports camp. So most of them are more physical activity. They haven't done a lot of arts programming specifically, which is I think why their interest came. But I invited the head of the DC Police Foundation to come and observe in Montgomery County and give me feedback because I didn't think we were doing anything quite on target. And I felt their officers and their programming was very smooth in terms of how they work with youth. So I had her come and tell me everything that we needed to improve. But she actually was very helpful and pointed out differences in terms of how they both operate. And then we started working from there. So both programs kind of influence and help each other out.
Great, so let's transition into just talking about successes. So, and you know, whoever wants to jump in first, that's fine. But talk to me about, or talk to us about the successes that you have seen with this program. What impact not only did it have on the community and the people that you're serving, but also on your theater companies?
One thing I'll say, when we did the evening performance and we made it available, a lot of people who had grown up in the Meacham Park area or who had grown up in Kirkwood and had not seen each other in 20 years came to the performance, and we had, as you do, a little, you know, repast afterwards so people could chat, and we had to ask people to leave. I mean, it was all of these connections that they had let go and were starting to make connections again. So it was really wonderful to see the community that had separated come back and take this opportunity to, and have since, some of them have talked to each other more and have kind of found that friendship again, which was not what we expected, had planned or thought would happen, but it was lovely to happen.
I think I've seen a difference just in terms of, one of the challenges with our project is you have a lot of adults in the room and a lot of alpha adults in the room. And the way a teaching artist responds is often very different to the way a police officer might respond to youth behavior. And I noticed a lot more listening towards the end. And a lot, I think improv teaches you to listen to something in full before responding. And I noticed a difference in terms of the relationships with the officers and youth, just in terms of, I think there was always a lot of love and care in the room, but I think in terms of just really listening and hearing the full story before reacting. And the other success I would say is just seeing the turnout from the parents was unexpected. I mean, like every relative of every kid was there with every cell phone videotaping every moment, but I was sort of blown away because, you know, I think the kids are really busy. They're very active in their schools, and I didn't know how much it would be.
So I knew you were going to ask this question, obviously, because you gave me a cheat sheet, but I found it really hard to think about the successes because I'm in a constant state of saying, what can we do better? What can we continue to push? How can our work be cutting edge? How can the youth voice be centered to everything that we do? In truth of fact, the statistical information about the lives of LGBTQ youth, particularly in Massachusetts, are getting worse, not better. So young people are queer and trans, young people are 4 times more likely to be threatened with a weapon in school in Boston than their straight ally or their straight peers. They're 6 times more likely to use heroin in a lifetime. I think there's this, the world sees much more queer and trans representation in society, right? And so there's this like, oh, job's done. We don't need to do any more work. We know these people exist. But what's happening is that young people are really suffering in silence, that they can't speak up, depending on what community they're from or what systems that they're part of, they can't speak up for themselves. And so they turn to other things in order to help them cope, right? And True Colors youth are paid to participate in the program. And a lot of them, it's their way they keep the lights on. It's the way they keep their cell phone on so that they can get that job interview. It's a source for them of a livelihood, though it's not much of a livelihood. So successes are that the space is still there for young people, and more community groups, government agencies, schools are open to the idea of the True Colors programming coming in and doing educational programming. It was a real struggle to book a tour in 2001 in Boston, I can tell you that. It was a real struggle to try and make that happen because it was seen as a recruitment mechanism. Are you recruiting people to be queer and trans? Is that why you want to come to our schools? And secretaries would hang up on me when I said what we did. They would just straight up hang the phone up. So that's a success, just community-wide, that that's not happening as much anymore, but it still happens. I'd say another great success is that the model of True Colors and creative youth development where it's asset-based and where the people who are impacted are the decision-makers. We use a similar model for the rest of our programming, which I think was a real success, to see how does this translate to the general community, this model of working with community and them making decisions about how money is spent and what they want to see on stage, I think has been a great success of the program.
Great, and let's stick with you for a moment here as well, because you've already alluded to some of the challenges that you have. So the next question is what are some of those challenges and lessons learned that inform your choices moving forward that you've had with these programs and projects? Sure, yes.
So I have to bring Nicole and Karen back in this room. They said so many things that were blew my mind. Thank you. And one of the things when we were talking about all the systems of oppression and how they interlock with one another, and it's such a, pardon me again, Mom, fucking mess. There's a way in which we all, if you are working in a nonprofit organization, are working in a system of oppression. It keeps wealthy people wealthy, and it keeps poor people poor, and it has this model of, there's a handout for you to do the little thing that you do, right? So there's this enormous power dynamic that we're constantly pushing up against. And so how do you work in that model, but totally tear it up from the inside out, right? And so I have to bring also Harold Stewart, who is a magnificent colleague of mine, who joined our organization a year ago. And the reason I'm the acting artistic director, our founder went on sabbatical and we're in a succession plan. And Harold and I have been doing this unpacking of systems. How is our organization upholding white supremacy every single day, every job application, every audition posting, everything that we do is upholding white supremacy culture, and how do we turn it on its head? So that is the challenge that will be before us forever, and one that I feel like understanding as a white person where I am in that fight is really significant, because I think Nicole said it, don't talk to black people, don't talk to people of color about your problems. White folks need to talk to white folks about how they can better the these organizations and better community and stop oppressing people of color. So that is, that's a world challenge and also the Theater Fest's challenge.
Joanna Marshall.
Well, I think being a one-off program, there is another challenge, as was stated earlier, to say thank you very much for bleeding and putting all of your heart out here, have a nice life and walking away. So I think it is, when you are doing a finite project, it's important to make sure that the stories that are told are the ones the community wants to tell and needs to hear, to make sure that there is a lasting effect and that you have changed ideas and you've also set up relationships between participants that will continue when you're not there to encourage it or to cause it to happen. That it doesn't need you as a player, that it is a lasting difference. And so I think that's a real challenge when you aren't in an organization that can do a long-term or has the structure to do a long-term, how to make these one-offs worth having been done.
I think it's finding the right artists on the project and for us. I think it's recognizing what bias am I bringing to the work, especially in terms of and really understanding reactions and understanding culture, both of the youth we're working with, but also of the officers. And I think the question I ask and continue to ask is how can we continue to make, and our partners work on it together, is how can we continue making this space safe for the youth, for the officers, and also the artists working. And that's a challenge.
So talk to me about your biggest takeaway. You know, what is now that you are either, you know, many years into a program, just starting the program or completing a project, what was the biggest takeaway or tip that you would share to everyone in this room who might be exploring similar work?
I think it's patience, go slow, and like the planning and the amount setting up. I mean, we talk, I have weekly conversations and still do with my point of contact from the unit that we're working with within the police. I have weekly conversations with the artists. So it's the amount of time set up in the planning process as well. But I think patience and being willing to sort of readjust along the way.
I would say that no matter how great your idea is, doing things alone is not the best way, and finding other organizations and community groups that can bring their insight and their talents make for a much stronger program. The rep could have done this by itself, but having the Meacham Park Neighborhood Improvement Association, having Webster Arts, having Springboard to Learning, just made it so much better. And then the artists that we brought in, and they brought in some ideas we hadn't put in there, and we were able to shift and say, oh, okay, we haven't thought of that. So I think it's having that structure, knowing exactly what you want to do, and then be ready to change it in a heartbeat when better information comes along, and find those partners.
Berkeley's not my friend, but I'm going to attempt to say, have communities that are impacted by decision making make the decisions.
So this is amazing, by the way. I think this is the first time I've ever seen or facilitated something where I said we are going to leave 10 minutes for Q&A, and we literally have 10 minutes. So we're going to turn it over to you for any questions that you might have.
members. So for
can you repeat the question?
Oh, sorry. I'll repeat the question. Asset management and transparency in your organization. So I have two examples. One is brand new, and another is has been going on for a while. So the our youth advisory board, the Leadership and Inclusion Council, we have allocated funds for that program, but the young people have made decisions about how that money gets spent. So they'll go through a process where we say, okay, I've done a first draft of this, and here's my justification for why I put it here, right? And then they will go and make adjustments. And there are a lot of programs that say, well, we can't trust young people with money, blah, blah, blah. But the fact is they make much better decisions than I do. It's just no lie. There are ways in which they see places to compress and expand that are really innovative. So if you have the opportunity to share that with young people, give them an overall number, give them a suggestion. Here's where we would allocate, here's where we would. Now, let's go through line by line and say where you would allocate. There's one example. Another example, which is a new thing for us, is that this particular fiscal year, we were budget crunch, and so we had to make some cuts. And so with the whole staff, we sat down and went through the history of budget. I'm not lying to you. The history of budgeting in our organization, how money got allocated, and then here's all the money that we'll make, line by line by line. Every grant we'll get, here's everything. And then here's how we would make cuts. Now we want to give your suggestions for how we would make cuts. And people were like, I think I can get a big donation for that one thing. I mean, it was like dollars. People were bringing it out. And so we had never done that as a full staff before, to just go through in depth to say, here's how the money gets spent. And it was with every single human being in our organization that we did that with. And some people like checked out, they were like, I didn't get it. You started talking about grants and I got lost, which means we have to go back and do work to say, how can you come to the table like everybody else, or as most people who have more budget experience? So that's new for us. But
like literally everyone in the room together.
Everyone in the room together, going through every piece of the budget. Yeah. That's you. You're one.
Yeah. This is about the policing program. So our organization has been asked by the mayor's office and by the chief of police to run something a little bit like this. And we just haven't found our way around it, so maybe you can help me think this through. So how have you been allowed to investigate and dig into the history and current state, the racist history and current state of law enforcement in our country and probably where you work, but definitely where I work in Cleveland? And how are you engaging in discussing questions with the ACLU to make sure your youth are protected after this program? And how do you avoid creating an unwise and unmerited trust in the police, which could put youth of color in danger in the future?
I don't have a response to out of three. It's that I need to continue looking into it, and I haven't looked into the ACLU would be my answer. To your first, it's spending a lot of time with the officers and building trust and spending time away from the youth with them to keep developing relationship. But I am constantly questioning if we're doing the right thing, is my honest answer to you.
And have you been able to have that conversation with the chief who asked you guys to be there?
Yes. I mean, he's doing it. This was his idea because he wants to make things better. So this was his brainchild with the Department of Recreation after several town halls. I don't honestly know if that's his what he's communicated. I can't tell you if that's honest, but I would like to hope.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yes. And then I wanted to ask you about the Truth Colors program. How do you, and I guess it's a little bit in conjunction with what Raymond said.
Can you speak up just a little bit?
Yeah. My question is in conjunction with Raymond's question. How do you keep students safe and protected? I work in a community that's a small town.
by the time that you share something in the morning, in the afternoon, everybody in town knows what happened, you know, and so it's a wonderful community to experience in the way that it really is a true reflection of it takes a village to raise a child, truly in that community, and I love that. But how do you protect in a community as such students that are dealing with some of these identity issues, and then how do you empower them in a community that can be very dangerous for them, where they expose themselves and can be completely shunned from the community in many ways? It can be so damaging to them.
Absolutely. So all of this is choice based. You don't have to tell your story. You don't have to go on tour. You don't have to tour in your community. So there has to be choice, and I do think that this is a place where devising and people telling their stories, it's a way in which organizations take advantage of that. Ooh, look, free stories, right? And that is not what this is. Every step of the writing process, they're making choices about whether they want to share this or not. Who they want, whether they want us to come to their school or not, is up to them. We don't make that decision. Someone might call us. We take the tour to the young people, and if someone says, I know a young person in that program, I don't want to do that gig, we don't do the gig, period. End of story, choice, all the way through. Empowering them in their own community. So, I would say a lot of young people test their limits and test who they are, you know, as we all do in exploring our identity, no matter what our identity ends up being. And so there's opportunity for them to come to programming. Now the studio programming, there's nothing public about it, so they can come to a workshop, try that out, go away, never come back again, right? So that's, again, part of it as well, is that you get to make a choice what program you're part of. Do you want it to be public? Do you want it to be private? And nobody knows who you are, right? So the empowerment part, there was a young person who would, and the other folks might resonate with this, who would change on the train. So he would be a he on the train and a she in programming, yes, and then would change again on the way home. And so that travel was part of a transition, right? And then she wrote a piece about that transition on the train, right? And then we saw, that was in Pariah, the movie Pariah, and I was like, oh, that's my young person's story. Nonetheless, that transition to a different community, because we're centrally located in a gang neutral space, or turf, there's not, turf wars aren't happening in that particular community. And so they gather there, and then we go out into the community and tour. So that's what I'd say, is that we're trying to create a safer space, or a brave space, as Nicole said, a braver space that they can go back out.
We have about time for two more questions.
What's the rep's philosophy in the education department on one-off programming? Do you have a particular reason why you do it? Or what's its goal?
The education director's philosophy is that there would be lots of continuing programs. The budgetary philosophy is we have a program called Wise Right, which is a residency we do with fifth graders every year on. They learn to write plays, and then we produce some of their plays on our main stage. That gets funded every year. Funders love that project. That happens every year. Other projects that are not related to any performance or audience development depend on what funding I can get for it. I would love to have a team that were doing amazing programs like this. I was the first education director at this theater. It's also learning the importance of education and changing that dynamic as well. But I'd rather do the one-offs and at least get to do something than say, I'm only going to do it if I can have a continuing program.
And I have a question over here.
Maybe this is for the True Colors artists, just because of the legacy and amount of time. I'm always interested in impact beyond kind of the one-off, and you just articulate why you couldn't. You actually alumni. I would think we'd love to hear a little bit about, right? Have you tracked that and how those youth have done, and not necessarily relative to others, you know, other youth that haven't gone through your program, but in terms of the well-being and the self-efficacy and things like that, have you been able to kind of follow your youth?
Yeah, for sure. So a lot of it happens over a dinner table, right? So there's folks that will gather together for a meal or a coffee and catch up. We have done an alumni survey, and I wrote the goddamn alumni survey, so here's my survey, is that who has a computer, who has the means and the time to fill out the form, and who has an address for me to send a check to for filling out the survey, yeah? So, miraculously, on our alumni survey, 100% of people went to college, and 60% went to grad school, right? And 98% are registered to vote. So there are all these ways in which it's revealing to me, and it's funny because we talked about, like, I shouldn't say this publicly, but I don't trust that form because it's way too pretty to be true, right? And the other part of that is if you do an alumni survey, those meals together, that coffee together, that's where you hear the real tea, where they will tell you, here is how I'm surviving. Here is how I'm thriving. Here is how I am suffering beyond the capacity that I have, right? And that's why I don't trust that alumni survey. So,
I don't trust surveys anyway. I was just reading the reasons that Nicole and other people alluded to.
Yeah.
Not just the sense of respond, but people tell you, like, Facebook.
Yeah, I think
you haven't done, like, a research, like, an independent people kind of, like, doing some of those interviews, who you're describing a little more formal. Yes.
So you just stepped into a big whole thing. We need to have lunch because the long-term stuff and assessment and evaluation is something we were going to get to. It is an addiction of mine. I will admit that openly. And so there's a lot of data there. I think the important thing for this audience to know is it can't just be a paper survey. Nicole said it earlier. It cannot just be a paper survey. That is not job done. Because if I just relied on that, it would look real pretty, real, real pretty, what our alums are doing. But I know better what's happening in their lives. And it is, in a lot of cases, surviving, or getting out of prison, getting a job. You know, there are ways in which it's about survival for the young people.
Great. So that wraps up this panel and all the time that we have for this. So thank you so much to our
it is now about